Do carbs make you fat? This isn't the video I wanted to make, but this is the video you need to see. The 8th of October 2019, the Danish Ministry of Environment and Food showed up on my feed after having released a video on Facebook. The video is in Danish, but its title translates to "Carbs aren't fattening, calorie surplus is," under the banner of a whole series that they've called Healthy or False. It's a short video, just under 4 minutes long, and because I'm just a human like everyone else with my bubbled beliefs and biases, I vehemently disagreed with many points in the video, wrote a stern comment, and then just left it at that. The morning after I had finally cooled down a bit, I thought, what good does it really do if I'm just caught up in my own bubble of knowledge and they really are on about something? So I took it upon myself to dig deeper, widen my understanding, brew some coffee and read some research papers. You see, I've always been fascinated by why it's so difficult to get to an agreement about food intake. And the analogy I like to use the most is that SpaceX has planned their first human flight to Mars by 2024, and we don't even agree on what to put in the space trip lunchbox. Probably gonna be something like a balanced diet, but the fact that we're trying to colonize other planets without agreeing on the nutrients is rather fascinating to me, and it just speaks to the complexity of the issue. Another issue, which is going to be important later in the video, is that there are many tools you can use for health-related improvements, but you're more likely to look out at the world with the tools you've been handed. A fitness instructor will use exercise, a nutritionist will use food, an endocrinologist will use your hormones. But that's for another video. Now I'm going to watch the whole video and point by point find out how they got to their conclusions. Unfortunately for me, they didn't cite any studies in the Facebook post, so I headed to their official website and found the same video. They cite some papers there, but absent was the first chart that they show in the video, indicating that carb intake has gone down in the United States and obesity has still risen. Now this is my first red flag. On the left-hand side, we have carb intake, which has risen from 410 to 500 and then makes a sharp drop. On the right-hand side, we have the amount of obese people, in percentages, going on a steady stream from 15% to above 35%. The problem is that the start and ending point for both y-axes are arbitrarily chosen to make the chart look exactly like it does. I tried to remake the same chart and immediately you have to do some data gymnastics to make the charts look like they do in an example. How does the chart look if the carb intake, which is the left y-axis, starts at zero? Or both of them start at zero? And why does the carb intake axis have to go to 550 when the highest point is 500? Then suddenly the chart just doesn't look very appealing. The reason for this misleading look is because the left side axis only has an increase of 67% and the right side axis has an increase of 400%, which means that the left axis is zoomed in, so to speak. Honestly, I rarely think of people being conspiratorial, but fiddling with this chart to make it look exactly like it does is not by accident. Furthermore, using the amount of people who are obese, which is defined by people who are above a certain body mass index threshold, BMI, which in this case is 30, is a bit shifty. Because it doesn't even take into consideration if your BMI was 38 and you lost a bunch of weight down to a BMI of 31, you would still be considered overweight and obese by this chart, which means it doesn't truly account for total weight loss. Maybe this chart could have looked different if averages of BMI were used, but I don't know if that data is actually available. I tried to find out who and why the chart was made, so I reverse Google image searched the chart and found the author of the original paper, who cites that the number from the chart are from the USDA, the United States Department of Agriculture, and the data is used for food availability in the country and is measured by how much is sold by retailers, not what is actually taken in by consumers. They do put forward, however, that their data is loss adjusted, but still, this data cannot be used as an actual intake. They even write that the data represents nutrients and foods available for consumption and not actual nutrient intakes by individuals. Now, let me give you an example. I make this fermented tea called kombucha, which needs to ferment for 10 to 14 days. In that fermentation process, I put a lot of sugar inside this bad boy, but 70% of the sugar is oxidized by the bacteria inside the bottle and not by me, which means that I don't consume 70% of the sugar that I buy. In 2012, a New York Times article came out criticizing exactly this. A new methodology came into place that shaved off 20 pounds of its estimates just like that, which is why the loss adjustment isn't the most reliable method for use in this case. But let's just say that the data is 100% valid. There's even more criticism to be made from this chart. Notice how the carb intake is still 470 grams of carbs per day in 2010, which is 1,880 calories just in carbs. And a fall from 2000 to 2010 is maximum 30 carbs. That difference is 2/3 of this piece of rye bread. And if you replace it with fats, it's approximately 20 grams of walnuts, which would equal the same amount of calories. Now, do you think this difference in your diet on a daily basis is going to make a large impact? I certainly don't think so. Now, the next piece of fact is a chart that shows that the increase in calories in the same period has primarily been from fats, followed by wheat products. I again did a reverse image search to find the author, which led me to this website where I found the same image. But the data is still taken from the USDA based on food availability, so take that data with a grain of salt. Other than that, it looks legit and plausible. All right, let's move on from this chart. The next point they make is...
En nylig gennemgang af 22 separate videnskabelige undersøgelser bekræftede desuden, at højt indtag af kulhydrat ikke var forbundet med en øget risiko for overvægt eller fedme.
Which does seem to check out with just a few caveats. They use a non-standardized instrument for total dietary and total carbohydrate intake, and they specifically write in their conclusion that further studies are needed that specifically classify refined versus unrefined carbohydrate intake, as well as studies that investigate the relationship between high-fat, high-unrefined carbohydrate sugar diets. Refined carbs being white bread, pasta, sugary drinks, breakfast cereals, and everything where it says added sugars. Unrefined carbs being fruits, whole grain bread, brown rice, oatmeal, and basically everything that can be considered whole foods. They go further in the video with this argument.
På trods af det er der stadig mange, der tror, at low carb er den bedste vej til vægttab, men det er altså heller ikke meget, der tyder på.
Whoa. Let me just stop here and go back to the same study that they just referenced. In the bottom section under results and discussion, they cite a lot of studies that put low carb in a positive light, contradicting their own statement. It says, low carbohydrate restricted calorie diets, high fat, have shown that they induce at least the same level or more of weight loss than their low fat, high carbohydrate counterpart diets. And then they cite some studies. Low carbohydrate diets also substantially reduce body weight, BMI, abdominal circumference, and they just keep going on and on and on and on about this. I mean, did they just read the conclusion? How can you possibly draw one certain conclusion from this as if Jesus himself resurrected and told you this is the absolute truth? Because there's a subtle difference between weight gain, which they cite in their conclusion, and weight loss, which they also cite in their results and discussion section. It's like the authors just, it's like they plucked all of the things they needed from the study and just moved on. And where did they move on to?
For nylig understregede en kæmpe undersøgelse, at det er mindst lige så effektivt at skære ned på fedtet, som det er at skære ned på kulhydraterne, hvis vægttab er målet. Faktisk pegede undersøgelsen på, at low fat var en anelse overlegent i forhold til low carb.
So the study he's talking about, I believe, is this one, due to it being one of the only references they cite on the website. And the study is actually quite surprising in my eyes. This chart shows a slight mean difference in energy expenditure and body fat that favors a low-fat diet compared to a low-carb diet. But what is the total result really? Yeah, it's 26 calories more in energy expenditure favoring low-fat, and a whole whopping 16 grams of fat, again, favoring the low-fat diet. What do you think of this difference? Even the study itself states that the effects are so small as to be physiologically meaningless. Meaningless. Much like the first chart I showed. I don't know about you, but I'm starting to see a pattern here. This absolutely minuscule difference could have gone either way just by pure chance or selection process of just one of the studies. I do find this to be very interesting because I know there are studies out there contradicting this, which is certainly an invitation to do more research, but to use the 16 grams argument? We're talking about 16 grams! So to use the word slightly superior in this context,
low fat but ain't only,
is not just misleading, but it smells of like a bias or agenda of some sort. I don't know why they would do this. What's even worse is that right under the chart, they write themselves that diets differing in carbohydrate and fat may have an overall health effect unrelated to total body fat or energy expenditure. Diets higher in refined carbohydrate possibly leading to increased visceral and liver fat, which is possibly the most unhealthy fat you can have on your body. The problem is you can have your studies here, then you can have opposing studies here. And what is wrong with those studies? You need to look exactly at why they're wrong and debunk them. Otherwise, you're just gonna live in your bubble of studies your whole life. And then you're gonna do this. You're gonna find a study, misrepresent the information, and just take the information you want from it. You have to debunk other people's studies. The same study we just looked at cites two studies that show greater short-term weight loss on low-carb diets compared with reduced energy low-fat diets. They do write further down that their study doesn't support this claim, but at least it's an interesting point. How come these studies are finding differing results? Don't get me wrong, I'm not a defender of low-carb. I'm also not a defender on high-carb. I don't like saturated fat. I also don't like sugar. I know there are a lot of studies about saturated fat. I know there are a lot of studies about sugar and how they're both bad for you, which is why this really surprised me. The Danish Ministry of Food have a YouTube channel where they've posted this whole Healthier Fall series, which has a couple of videos, but what stands out is that there's a video about fat in particular, which puts fat in a negative light. And absent from this list is a video about sugar. Why? Well, coincidence could be an explanation. But I found that one of the guys in the video has a website, and more specifically a blog there, in which every single blog post either points to fats being the main issue about food intake, or that there's no problem eating sugar, or more specifically, the only reason sugar is bad is that it contains calories and no vitamins and minerals. There's even a whole blog post about the myths of sugar in which the goddamn same chart is used. Just for sugar this time around instead of carbohydrates. This same criticism applies to this chart. What is up with trying to make the correlation here so apparent by manipulating the starting points? The y-axes are still way different in percentages, and the BMI statistic is still here. This chart is useless and tells us nothing about the correlation between sugar intake and stored fat. And remember, the data is still from the United States Department of Agriculture, which is food availability and not actual intake. However, we're gonna move on to my biggest disagreement with this video.
Men jeg kender der en, der har tabt sig på low carb, tænker du så måske nu. Det kan man også godt. Det har bare ikke noget med kulhydrater at gøre.
So they go on to talk about how calories are the most important factor in weight loss, and the rest of the video just tries to bang out this point. And also some point about insulin not being a part of fat storage, which I won't touch in this video in fear of making an hour-long mess out of this. But is a calorie just a calorie? And while that statement in itself is true, there are many ways to solve the problem when it comes to caloric intake and caloric output. It's like asking, how can you make a car drive very far? Well, you can try to expand its fuel reserve, or you can try to optimize or minimize its fuel consumption, both which are valid strategies. I'll get back to this in a bit so you can hear another strategy than calorie counting for weight loss. Anyway, on the Danish Food Ministry website, which hosts this video, and which is supposed to tell you about nutrition, you can read all about the 9 official diet advice, one of which is eat less sugar. Now, before I click this link, I thought it would just mention something about tooth decay and maybe sugar just being empty calories with no nutritional value. But it actually states that foods and drinks with a lot of sugar increases the risk of obesity. Paradoxically, if you go back and click on the advice on fat, it doesn't even mention obesity. Maybe they just haven't updated their advice yet, but this isn't really very convincing. And look, even I agreed that the fat advice should be changed because in combination with unrefined carbs, saturated fat really isn't the most healthy or slimming food. I want you to ask yourself this. Does any food, regardless of its micronutrient value, only impact your body composition by its caloric content? If so, what is the difference between someone who has a hard time gaining weight and someone who has a propensity to gain fat very easily? How does your body even know how to partition the food you ingest? I know insulin is a controversial topic, but what about the hormone balance as a whole? And let's be completely clear about our goals when we're talking about weight loss. We're really talking about fat loss. In many cases, your weight can stay almost the same, but your body composition will be remarkably different. Let's just mention testosterone as an example. A study from 1996 put 40 men into 4 groups. The first group trained naturally. Group 2 took 600 milligrams of testosterone every week and trained. Group 3 took 600 milligrams of testosterone every week and did not train. And the fourth group was the placebo group. The results are a little surprising because the group that did not train but got testosterone gained more lean muscle mass than the group that trained. This is important because there are also studies showing how your diet can also alter your testosterone levels. It shows how men who prefer Western style foods, bread and pastries, dairy products and desserts, are found to have an unhealthy body composition and low serum total T levels, suggesting there's a correlation between either being overweight and getting low testosterone, or having lower testosterone has made them gain more fat. Studies also exist explaining that sugar sweetened consumption is significantly associated with low serum testosterone in men, 20 to 39 year olds in the United States. plenty of studies showing that an increase in testosterone can lead to significant weight and fat loss, so let's make a full circle here. Your diet can affect your testosterone, which in turn will make your body partition fuel worse, which will make you gain fat and possibly lose more testosterone and gain more fat. By changing your diet from unhealthy foods, getting enough sleep, lowering your cortisol stress hormone, you can heighten your testosterone levels naturally and burn more fat, create more muscle, and get a healthier body composition. And don't be afraid like you're gonna get absolutely huge by having a healthy amount of testosterone, because building and maintaining muscle mass requires a significant amount of calories, which are then not stored as fat. My biggest inspiration into studying this area is Dr. Peter Attia, who is a doctor focusing on longevity. Many of his patients want to get into shape to be able to live a long and healthy life. And he says this in an interview with Joe Rogan.
And I got to tell you, I know we love to beat up on fat people. Mm. We love to turn it into a character defect. But I got to tell you, virtually every fat person that I know or that I've taken care of, they are not disproportionately eating more than their peers. In some cases, yes, but not on balance. The problem is that they simply do everything incorrectly metabolically.
Mm. You know, so their body is functioning incorrectly.
Yeah, it's
I think
there's a genetic component. I think there are dietary exacerbations. I think certainly not exercising makes things worse.
Then he goes further and states,
with cortisol levels, that's exacerbated by stress, right?
Yes.
So stress actually exacerbates your weight gain.
Absolutely.
You could literally eat the same diet and gain more weight because of stress.
Absolutely.
Wow.
This is true because there are studies done on the effects of cortisol on testosterone, which conclude that cortisol have a highly significant negative effect on circulating testosterone concentrations. So while it all ends up with calories, I would say no to the fact that a calorie is just a calorie. Because different foods have different effects on your body, which in turn is going to change your body composition accordingly. So refined sugar is not just problematic because it's empty calories with no nutritional value. It's problematic because it significantly reduces our body's ability to partition fuel to our advantage. And with this said, even most artificial sweeteners will not only have a negative effect on your body in the form of them being carcinogenic, but an overuse is highly likely to affect your hormones negatively, even though they're literally zero calories. Remember that the video I'm criticizing is in collaboration with the Danish Food Ministry and is most likely spending Danish people's tax money on this, which I feel is actually misinformation. And the amount of support in the comment section is slightly worrying. In my opinion, a very biased view was had when researching and making this video. And when I said, "But you're more likely to look out at the world with the tools you've been handed," it is clear that the only lens at which they are viewing the world through is calories. Why, hello, Private. Thank you so much for watching if you made it this far. This video took an absolutely massive amount of time to make, so if you like, you can like the video, comment, share it, whatever you want to do to it. If you want me to make more content, subscribe and flick that little bell so you won't miss further content. And that's it. It's been the Command Sergeant Major General, and thank you so much for watching, Private. Over and out.